So now it's time for the rest of our session to focus on Tapa. We'll be starting in the Asia Pacific region. Today we're delighted to be joined from Singapore by Tony Lugg, Acting Chairman and Chairman-elect for 2023 to 2025 of Tapa APAC. Tony, thank you so much for making the time to join us and be with us today.
Thank you very much for the invitation and the opportunity to speak to you all. So look, I'm actually at the Supply Chain Asia Awards Conference, so excuse me for having to step out and try and find somewhere nice and quiet. So if you do hear some noise, I'll try and speak up and put the mic on.
Thank you, Tony. Well, we really appreciate you finding the time to fit us in with your busy schedule, so thank you. First of all, let me say welcome back as chair of Tapa APAC. How does it feel to be back in the driving seat again?
So look, Tapa's been in my blood since like 2002, you know, where, you know, I, as you probably know, I was involved in Operation Grafton at Heathrow Airport. And look, when I relocated to Asia in 2008, the board helped me, you know, get into the board at Tapa in the APAC region. And look, you know, we took some great ideas there, managed to transform it. And it's just brilliant to be back to try and really, you know, jump on that sort of growth that we had and to try and continue it.
What would you say are your main objectives looking ahead to next year? What will be your main objectives for 2023 as you start your period as chairman?
So I think COVID that's actually taught us that we can do things differently. And I think, you know, if you look at some of the progress that's been made in the online training, I think it really shows that we can do things differently. We can reach out to a wider audience. We can help members actually save costs, you know, in terms of travel and things of that nature. So I don't think there's any going back on it. And that's right. I think we should do as much as we can to enhance it. But what it made me do, it made me kind of think, look, we need to do something different. And so what we will be doing in Asia is looking at some advanced courses to really help the members skill up further. In terms of the membership, myself and the board have committed to double the membership within 3 years. And to do that, I have to bring in a good team. So you'll see that our secretariat will be, you know, similar to yourselves, but somewhat smaller. But with those initiatives, we're actually going drive that membership that you know that we should be having in Asia. Right, we are the largest manufacturing base, and that's what we intend to do. Is to go out there and push that supply chain program through all manufacturers and not just a few.
Lots of exciting objectives there for next year. And outside of the standards and trainings, do you see perhaps more alignments with the other regions?
So look, I've always been a one Tapa person. And so, you know, my message to everybody today is that the board are fully behind my plan to, you know, get back to Tapa One. I think it's important, you know, especially our global members. They want a single program. They want the same standard, the same rules, guidelines, etc., across the whole of their global supply chain. So, you know, certainly you will see that I will be pushing for that alignment and to make sure that, you know, we are going in that direction.
And how can Tapa EMEA support Tapa APAC, both with that goal and perhaps more widely as well?
Well, you know, as I said earlier, I think what we have to do is be clever. There's no point reinventing the wheel. And I've already looked at some of the tools that Tapa EMEA have created, and they are. They're excellent. So, you know, again, why don't we try and drive standardization? And that keeps the members happy. That's what they want. They want the same standard, whether it's Asia, Americas, or Europe. And, you know, we will certainly be sitting down with the team there, with Marcel, Torsten, and the rest of the board, and looking at how we can do that in terms of the online training, leverage off of that, and certainly in terms of the TIS tool.
You just mentioned the TIS tool there. I don't know if you want to talk more about that, but I was going to ask you anyway. Are there any particular areas that you think are working really well that Tapa EMEA is doing? Something that you admire that's being done here?
Yeah, sure. I mean, look, you know, even if I just start on the with the training, you've made significant developments and progress there. Look, I think there's even an opportunity for us to create a new level of membership, which I'll be discussing with Marcel and Torsten and the rest of the team. And that really is to appeal to, you know, companies like DHL, and congratulations to DHL, by the way. I was in Vietnam last week handing them award, you know, 100 Tapa A sites in Asia, and I just heard the news of the 400th coming up in EMEA. So it's brilliant news. But if you look at organizations like that, they're putting so much effort into Tapa, and we should look at a membership structure which supports them. So that'd be one thing that I'd be doing. In terms of the TIS tool, we should be providing this data and this opportunity to provide risk assessments, which are recognized by Homeland Security for your CTPAT audits, where you have to do them, or AEO, or in Singapore, our STP Plus program. Look, all of those are add value to the members. And, you know, we have the data, we have the systems, we have the processes, so we should leverage off of that to give the members as much value as possible.
Earlier on, you mentioned One Tapa. What's your vision for 2025, and where do you think Tapa should be? So Tapa with APAC, Americas and EMEA, where should they be by 2025?
So again, you know, as I said earlier, if you look at One Tapa, if you look at the roadmap we have, if you look at the size of the membership and our intention to double the membership, or even treble the membership. We are the largest manufacturing base. I think when we did the workshop with Torsten and the team, you know, we established there was something like 87,000 in terms of addressable or potential members, and we're only literally just touching the surface on it. So I think there's a lot of work we can do to actually professionalize the organization to take it to the next level. We can't do this on a part-time basis. It doesn't work. And we can't run it like tea clubs because that's not what the members want. And certainly when I came back into the role, you know, people were applauding me coming back. You know, it's a voluntary role and it takes up a lot of your time. I've put a lot of effort into this. The members actually realize that. So the members' expectation is that we take that further. And that's what I intend to do. Tend to sit down with all regions and literally push that agenda, that we've got to get that alignment in place in terms of standardization process. We have to, it's got to be the same cup of coffee wherever you drink it across the world, and that's where we need to get to. So the vision for 2025 is that we should be at that level where we have a global membership, that we have all of those regional support. And, you know, the members are fully supported in every region, whatever their requirements are.
Well, Tony, it sounds like you have a really busy time ahead, and we wish you and the Tapa APAC team every success with that, including the goal to double your membership. And thank you so much for making time to come and join us, and we'll look forward to catching up again soon.
Thank you very much. And if any members, you know, need any help and support, please reach out to me, and I'll certainly give them that.
Thank you, Tony. Thanks again.
Thank you again.